Dorsey teaches history at the University of New Hampshire. He teaches a wide variety of popular history courses, but his special interests include U.S. foreign policy. What an apt time to be in that. And the history of Canada. And get this, he also specializes in environmental history. And tonight's program will focus on that. This year is the 100th anniversary of the passage of the Migratory Bird Treaty Act. And I assume that all of you realize that this treaty has been the basis for much of the protection of our wild birds. I asked Kurt, he assured me that he does have justification for the somewhat unusual title of tonight's talk. So sit back as Kurt relates the remarkable story, which he titled, Of Mallards and Men, the Migratory Bird Treaty Act of 1918. Welcome.
Thank you, David. Thank you for the call coming out. I'm glad to say it's Tuesday. It's not snowing. This is a victory in itself. One of the courses I love to teach at UNH is the freshman survey, modern U.S. history. So if you want to make me feel at home, if like half of you would fall asleep and then I'm going to text the whole class. let me just make sure I don't trip over a cord or keep banging my grand feet on keys or once. Okay. So when I started graduate school at a classified year a long time ago, I had just been reading a textbook in U.S. foreign policy, and there was literally half a sentence. In 1916, the United States and Canada signed a treaty to protect the migratory birds of North America, comma, and something else which I didn't remember. And I thought, wow, that's pretty cool. I could maybe write a research paper on that. And since I was just starting graduate school, and I was much more focused on being a smart ass than actually getting research done, I came up with this title before I had done anything else. And because I was in graduate school, one of the first things my professor said is, it's the equivalent of that's gender specific, so you can't use that title. And so I said, oh, okay. So I came back with some alternatives. As it turned out, he left Northwestern shortly after that. And when the book came out, I do have a copy of the book, which is based on the dissertation I eventually wrote on early 20th century conservation treaties. They had her let me keep a balance of men. I'm pretty sure it's because he warned her the consequences of challenging them 2 months ago. So I kept it. There was partially an homage to a Steinbeck, but you will find out there are plenty of women in the story. So, this treaty from 1916, which is largely forgotten, although unfortunately, it's been in the news recently because there have been efforts to push back on it for the first time since 1918. This treaty is a pretty unique moment in American history, really in conservation history, long before we generally think of environmental diplomacy. We think of that as like a 1970s thing. The United States and Canada was still part of the British Empire, so Great Britain organized the treaty on Canada's behalf. But Canadians really negotiated a treaty to protect pretty much every species, not quite everyone, they weren't quite ready to protect predators at this point, that crossed the U.S.-Canadian boundary, which was the vast majority of birds in North America at the time. And what I want to talk about today is not only what's in that law, but where it came from, the treaty and the law that came out of it. There was a very effective lobbying campaign. So I do think there are lessons for modern environmental issues. As I argued in my book, you can't just have an economic argument, but you also can't just have an aesthetic argument. You've got to be able to sell both the economics and the aesthetics to make a conservation treaty work. And even though the treaty was signed in 1916, after 3 years of work getting to the treaty stage, it still took 2 years for the treaty to really become law, because a treaty without enabling legislation is pretty pointless. If Congress does not, A, change the laws of the country to match the treaty, and B, actually put some money behind the enforcement, then what you've got is a symbolic gesture rather than an actual law that's worth anything. So let me talk a little bit about where this treaty came from, and as we go along, I'll tell you what's in the treaty, in this treaty act, as we celebrate the 100th year, and hopefully we'll make it to 102 years of the Migratory Bird Treaty Atkinson. In the early 20th century, there was a widespread recognition that there were great threats to nature in North America. That didn't mean anybody was going to do anything about it, because for a lot of Americans, the reality was that the threat to nature was just part of the price of progress. If you're going to get rich, you've got to tap resources. And there was a sense of superabundance, that that North America, particularly the United States, had been blessed with such an abundance of resources that you could never really destroy them. But in 1913, William Hornaday, who was a very prominent conservationist at the time, published a book with this wonderful image of all the different people who were attacking and technologies that were attacking wildlife. So you can see in the forefront, first of all the hunting dogs, which are including this one scratching himself, so there's a complete, and then this one sleeping, which would probably be my dog, that were making hunters more effective. Of course, all of them are carrying guns of various kinds, but particularly some of them using the new automatic or pump gun technology that made it easier to shoot more quickly. In addition, the army was divided, and you can see, obviously, it reaches back to the horizon. There are the people who were market hunters. The market hunters were people who shot birds to sell in the markets of the great cities in the east. And while we have a definition of game birds, it would be like ducks, basically, maybe turkeys, things like that. A prominent biologist from the late 19th century reported seeing dozens of different species of birds, in the New York City markets, including songbirds. You literally could buy robins. You know, 420 blackbirds in a pie? Those are basically, you know, European robins. They're robins, tourist species. You could put robins in pies, meadowlarks in pies. Other people who Hornaday criticized were so-called sportsmen who hunted just for sport, but he was critical of them for hunting more than their fair share. Although sportsmen generally will not come under criticism from conservationists this time period. This is the one I think is most interesting. Aliens, we kill the songbirds. And here's a guy with a mustache. I mean, he was trying to draw a stereotypical Italian. I think he did it right there. But there was a lot of criticism of Southern blacks and Italian immigrants among the conservationist community. So the conservationists were not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. They certainly had their racist and ethnic biases. So this is a really powerful image of who they saw as a threat. Of course, there was a reason they saw a threat. The late 19th century saw the end of the passenger pigeon as a wild species. And of course, the passenger pigeon dies out in the Cincinnati Zoo in 1914. But long before that, it was effectively an extinct species, and we've got these famous images of the clouds of birds and people shooting them, and there, you know, dogs eating the carcasses on the ground, trains full of carcasses being shipped to big city freights, passenger pigeons direct to you, and then all the different ways that people kill and gather passenger pigeons, particularly gather their squabs, the chicks, for fine restaurants in the east. The decline and end of the population of passenger pigeons helped crystallize among Americans that actually they could end parts of nature in North America. That no matter how abundant a species was, it could be driven to extinction. The bison, the decimation of bison at the same time was also driving on this lesson. And that, I think, helps change the way Americans thought about what they can do with nature. So, let's dig in a little bit of the people who were considered to be at fault. Game hogs and market hunters. So the gentleman on the far side, it's not really fair to label him a game hog, but there were plenty of images like this from the early 20th century. Clearly, he's not going to eat all those ducks. He shot them for sport. I do have to say that the first time I gave a version of this talk at Seacoast Audubon, Davis Finch, the great bird guy, was sitting in the front with the binoculars and identified the ducks. I was really impressed. He said, "Those are South American teal." I said, "Oh, South American teal." So that's what he said they were, and I believed in anything Davis Finch tells me about birds. This is a picture definitely more from the time period, the early 20th century. But these guys, while they're not intending to, they're not shooting these for sport, they're shooting them for the market, and of course, there were, as I said earlier, many species that were intended for the market. So the idea that you should take more than you could eat was one of the first that conservationists rallied to attack and tried to make sure that it would not be possible to shoot large numbers of animals for the market, and certainly not to be a game hog. Being a game hog was unsporting. The idea of one's sporting and sportsman was definitely up for debate in the early 20th century. But it was not just the game hogs and the male hunters. Of course, there was a strong argument against millinery trade or decorating hats. So my guess is you've heard various versions of the story. Most birders are aware of the story. But it's really remarkable the picture you can find in the early 20th century, late 19th century, of what people put on their heads in this sort of arms race, or unfortunately in this case, a wings race, of people decorating their hats with showier and showier items, including whole, small birds, owls, things like that. If you've ever been to the Lab of Ornithology at Cornell, they have that case of hummingbirds. You know, they weren't for hats, but basically they're the same thing. It was a decorative thing you could have in your item, in your house. You could have a case of hummingbirds if you were willing to pay for it. So the idea of birds as decoration primarily was widespread among American women, and it particularly showed a certain level of class. If you could have the nicest hat, you were a more well-to-do person. Now, this is obviously a much more modern book. The people were very unhappy that you were a bird on your head. So there were lots of threats. I won't even get into the habitat threat because they were not aware of habitat as a problem in the early 20th century. This is not something they were focused on until at least the 1920s. So, in response to these perceptions of threats, there were attempts to organize people and organize movements to pressure the government to do something about it. So this is George Bird Grinnell. One of the things I discovered in my research is there's like a 50% chance your middle name will be Bird. If you end up in this conservation story, there's another bird, Burnham. So I don't know if the birds were all related or whether somehow their parents just sensed this guy's going to grow up to be a bird conservationist. George Bird Grinnell was a well-to-do Eastern industrialist. He came from a wealthy family. He was an explorer of the West. He was on one of Custer's expeditions, obviously not the one that didn't end so well for Custer, but the one before that, the Black Hills. And when he came back to the East in the 1870s and 80s, he was concerned about what was going on. So he founded, on his own, the very first Audubon Society and put out the very first Audubon magazine in 1887. As you can see, there aren't a lot on the left because the only one that's left with an image is stained. Somebody's really cut a copy of it, unfortunately. But Grinnell had this idea that he would just get people to send him their addresses, and he would organize them and send them this newsletter. He did not charge dues. This could give you a suggestion of how wealthy he was. He had 30,000 people respond to his call for the first Audubon Society. And as wealthy as he was, he could not sustain a 30,000 person organization on his own. And this new Audubon organization folded quickly, but it still brought attention to the problem. A lot of people started thinking we could do something to work for our country's birds. Grinnell at least planted the Audubon idea. It was not just the conservationists like Audubon, there was also the rise of science and to a certain extent government. This is C. Hart Merriam. Anybody run across Merriam in their ecology classes by any chance? So Merriam was one of the late 19th century pioneers, early 20th century pioneers in ecology. He worked for the Bureau of Economic Ornithology and Mammalogy. That's an organization crying out for a shortening of the name. And it later became the Biological Survey. And then later became the Fish and Wildlife Service. So after a few name changes. So the forerunner of the Fish and Wildlife Service, Merriam was one of the chief scientists there. He's a famous ecologist. He came up with the idea of poking around Arizona. He was climbing mountains. And when he got to the top of the mountains, he felt like he was in British Columbia. And he said, wow, there's something strange going on here. As you climb the mountains, you're getting different ecological zones, both with plants and animals. And so he was one of those first Americans to really put together some of the ecological ideas of community. But he was also a government servant, and he was concerned about the attack on the native bird populations. So with the Bureau of Economic Ornithology and Mammalogy, take a breath after I say it every time, Merriam started calling on a network of volunteers. He built a network of volunteers around the country to just report information about migration, just so they could start gathering knowledge. They didn't know enough to figure out how to start protecting the nation's birds. And in 1915, the New York Times reported that Merriam's office had 500,000 facts about migration. Apparently no theories, but 500,000 facts. So at least it was a start. And they could start imagining that what can we do about protecting particularly migratory birds. This is Harriet Hemingway, one of the early founders, or founders of one of the first Audubon movements that actually worked because they collected dues. This is, she helped found Mass Audubon. And if you were members of Mass Audubon, maybe late 90s, because when I lived in Massachusetts, she was on the cover, this image in particular, was on the cover of Sanctuary, their magazine. Hemingway and her other relatively well-to-do society women, and there are a lot of people doing similar things in the progressive era, late 19th century, early 20th century. Their domestic sphere is to not go out and work. They're well-to-do women. They need to contribute to society in some way, part of it by raising families, but also through volunteer work. And so there's a huge range of things they do that become part of the progressive movement, like helping immigrants adjust to the United States, leading campaigns for pure food and pure milk and pure drugs. Hemingway and her friends were particularly motivated when they started learning about what was behind the feathers on hats. And so in 1896, she got together with some of her friends. They got together with a few of the male scientists in the area, particularly from Harvard, and they formed the Massachusetts Audubon Society. And the early Audubon societies are all state organizations. They didn't merge until much later. And it's really striking if you look at the membership rolls from the early years. They're heavily female. There'll be a relatively few males, most of them are scientists, and then a lot of women, most of them, but certainly not all, are society women who have the time and resources to organize. And they start organizing state Audubon societies around the country, and they start pushing for legislation to change the ways in which Americans think about birds, not just as targets, but as resources. But you still have to drum up support, and you need multiple avenues if you're going to drum up support for conservation initiatives. So this guy who's standing in the way in the front, I don't know who that was, but the guy with the beard in the back is John Burroughs, who's one of the best known writers of the first decade of the 20th century. John Burroughs is a nature writer of some fame. He was published in popular magazines, he wrote many books, and he was very good at turning nature stories into something that average Americans could relate to. So one of my favorites in reading Burroughs' old books, he talked about a battle for a nesting site between a bluebird and a wren. And the bluebird, he depicted as a police officer in his bright blue uniform, chasing the wicked, rusty street demon, which I had to get Caroline around. Pretty much all the wrens would be wicked, rusty street demons. But he was part of this movement through writing, through literature, to draw Americans into this idea that birds were more interesting, they weren't something you should target, you should actually try to protect and understand them. He was certainly not alone. Ernest Thompson Seton, who was sometimes Seton Ernest Thompson, he changed his name quite a bit, so you can find his name differently in different books. He was probably as popular as Burroughs, and he published a lot of books. But he also seemed to push the envelope in telling the stories. You know how when you watch Star Trek and things like that, you say, you know, physics doesn't actually allow you to do that. When you read his stories, you say, you know, biology doesn't actually allow that to happen. But they were good stories, and people liked reading them. And he never really said they were completely true, although when you have a title like Wild Animals I Have Known, that sort of sounds like a bird you might have met, an animal you might have met. And most of these stories are, they're not just about birds, they're about mammals. He has one about Mary Yek Yek, the prairie. So he takes various common species and weaves stories around their lives, and usually gets the science, you know, like 80% right, which is pretty good in my class. That would give a B minus. So he gets a B minus on the science. He also sparked a brief, an intense debate that drew in Theodore Roosevelt from the previous picture about nature fakery. There was a famous story attached to him about a woodcock who was wounded in a hunting accident. The woodcock wasn't hunting, he was the target. Wounded in a hunting accident, who broke his leg in the hunting accident, and then took some mud and sticks and made a cast for his leg. So Seton's book, Wild Animals I Have Known, soon got called Wild Animals I Alone Have Known. Because maybe he was making parts up here. But the point is that the President of the United States, among other people, was brought into this kind of debate over what's real and what's fake in nature? And does everything you write about have to be real if it drums up support, if it drums up sympathy? If you start thinking of the woodcock as a sentient being that could say, hey, I need a cast, how am I going to make a cast, rather than, ow, that hurt, then maybe you start thinking differently. Mabel Osgood Wright was one of the most formidable writers of the time period. She was not as widely distributed, but she certainly made an impact because she was the, in effect, society page columnist for the very first Audubon magazine, Birdboard, which would come out every 2 months. And it was her job to collect information from around the country, from the new Audubon societies, and distribute it to help them see how the other organizations were actually doing things. She was incredibly influential that way because she was the one person who was in every single issue of Bird Lore. She also was a widely published author. So Birdcraft is a book teaching how birds would, for instance, make nests and how you might be able to go out and find them and learn about them out in the wild. It's not quite a field guide, but it's still a book you could potentially take out in the field. Remember, field guides at this point are just starting. And she's giving people material they can take into the field and use to learn things about birds. She also wrote this really powerful, interesting idea, Citizen Bird, with Elliott Coos, who's a famous scientist. But this is a time when citizenship in the United States is very much under discussion. There are waves of immigrants pouring in the 1880s and 90s. And there are huge questions, and particularly among the urban reformers. How are we going to integrate these people into our society? And so here she is trying to take this question about citizenship and connect it to birds. That birds actually are committing, are doing things for society that we should be taking pride in, we should be defending. She was acerbic when she needed to be. She particularly loved to take on women who wore bird parts on hats. And she had one comparison that the women who like to wear birds on hats were clearly real voidies, you know, like the New York City accent, who loved to spit as they were riding on the subway. You know? So she's like, she had a cutting wit that she would take apart anybody who she thought was opposed to birds. In one of her stories, insists her two young siblings, brother and sister, go out to the country to visit their uncle, who was very subtly named Dr. Roy Hunter. Dr. Roy Hunter, it's when they are mad, I think the owl keeps them up at night or it seems dangerous, explains to them that actually the owl is doing a very important job on the farm by controlling pests. This is a pretty radical idea in the early 20th century, that you don't shoot the birds of prey, you actually think about an ecological relationship. That's not the word she used, but that's what she's talking about. To put this in context, William Hornaday, who I just picture I showed from 1913, in his book, Our Managed Wildlife, where you know, he's listing all the people who are shooting birds, he has sections about what to do about predatory birds. The Cooper's hawk, he said, should be executed whenever possible because it's bad. Likewise, the sharpshinned hawk. The red-tailed hawk might occasionally eat a chicken, but it eats enough rats to make up for it, so don't shoot that one. So even this person who is hammering everybody who's willing to shoot birds is willing to make an exception for people who shoot exhibitors because they're bad predators. So for her to defend the great horned owl, this was suggesting some debate among the ranks of conservationists at the time. She also was important for helping to emphasize the role of teachers. If we were going to change the way Americans thought about birds, we had to start with the kids. Exactly. So here, I kind of doubt anything but house sparrows lived in any of those boxes. But that's not really the point, right? The point is that the junior Audubon class in Fergus Falls, Minnesota. So that was probably like August, so they could finally strip out of their winter clothes. We're building birdhouses because they were being taught that the lesson was to support their wild birds, not to attack them. There's a lot of literature at this time period about boys. The boys were out slingshots killing the young birds and female birds, and they should not be doing that. And there was also finally a scientist, Frank Chapman, who was from the American Museum of Natural History. Some called him the birds historian because he tried to tell the story of the birds. And he came out with what was really the first field guide that was really designed to go out and help you identify birds in the field in the early 20th century. And so Chapman was a powerful voice for getting to conserve birds, but first knowing them so you could understand what you had. You know, Hornaday says, shoot the Cooper's hawks believe the red-tailed hawks. I don't know how many people can tell the difference. Right? We get problems all the time with identification if you just see it up in a tree or flies by. So it would help if you actually could identify the birds before you decide whether or not they're good or bad. So this is the movement. The movement is irrelevant without policy.
I should say irrelevant, but it's not going to get to the Migratory Bird Treaty Act unless you have some policy.
So the first person who took seriously this idea that there should be some sort of legislative difference made out of this movement was the congressman named John Lacey. Lacey wrote the aptly named Lacey Act, which was about one page long in the days of, you know, 10,000 page pieces of legislation. It's kind of charming to think that there was an important bill that somebody actually could read in about 5 or 10 minutes to read carefully. Lacey in 1900 proposed to Congress that it would be illegal to ship birds that were killed illegally in one state into another state. That this would be a federal responsibility. Now we have to step back. You know, we live in an era where pretty much everything is a federal responsibility. But 100 years ago, it wasn't. The definition of what was a state power was much broader. And the idea that the federal government could step in and regulate anything having to do with wildlife was radical. These were state issues and state property. In fact, Grinnell, who I showed earlier, was a member of the American Ornithologist Union, which came up with a model law in the 1890s that they wanted to pass. And they specifically decided they had to attack each state by state, because it wasn't the federal government's job to regulate any sort of wildlife. But Lacey said the Constitution includes the Interstate Commerce Clause, and selling birds across state lines, so like if you shot a bunch of ducks in Currituck Sound, North Carolina, and tried to ship them to the New York market, that's interstate commerce. The federal government can't regulate that. So with that simple act, he introduced the concept of federal regulation of wildlife hunting. 6 years later, George Shiras, who was a nature photographer back in Pennsylvania, came forward with this idea that actually the federal government had the right to regulate migratory birds in general. This was a huge intellectual breakthrough. And he got the idea riding a regulated train crossing state lines, because the federal government had taken on itself the right to regulate interstate transit on trains, particularly for sanitary reasons. He was particularly noticing that there were rules about what you could do with human waste on a train when you cross state lines. He thought, if you could have that, why couldn't you have something that protects wildlife across the state lines? And so in Congress in the 1906 session, he was elected in 06, so the 07 session, he proposed protection for migratory birds. And nobody cared. Instead of coming back and fighting for it, he served his one term and decided he would go back and be a photographer for the rest of his life. And that sort of killed the idea. Even though people like Theodore Roosevelt noticed it and endorsed it, it was still so far from the mainstream of politics that he was going to have a hard time selling. But keep in mind, C. Hart Merriam and his 500,000 volunteers, 500,000 facts, his 1,000 volunteers picking up information and sending it in. Scientists and bird observers were learning the mysteries of migration. They were starting to piece together the idea of flyways. They were starting to think that instead of the state of Ohio has birds, that birds that are in the state of Ohio one day might be in Canada the next, or in the fall they might be down in Alabama the next. And as they started thinking more carefully about migration, people started saying, this cannot be a state problem. The state cannot solve any regulatory issues to protect migratory wildlife. It has to be a federal idea. In fact, maybe it has to be international. Into the discussion came a young worker named T. Gilbert Pearson, who was second in charge of the Young Audubon Society in the early 20th century behind a guy named William Dutcher. Dutcher fell by a stroke. He lived, so he retained his position, but Pearson basically became the man leading the Audubon Association, which was how the state Audubon Societies worked together. Pearson was an interesting guy. On one hand, he certainly liked nature, and he wrote books about nature. And I'm just going to put up this picture because, you know, his margin to me was so dying. So he did talk about colleagues breeding birds like this. But Pearson was also very much an organizer. In fact, really, in terms of Audubon's history, he's much more important as an organizer than as a nature guy. Pearson once said that the happiest sound he ever heard was the membership fees clinking into a box. Think about that for a bird. You know, wasn't the Scarlet Tanager singing or, you know, the woodcock painting? No, clink, it was a nickel into the box. So, but that organization was really important, right? Because you can love birds all you want, but you've got to get people focused on the job. And in 1913, Pearson said, you know what we really need to do? We need to get that Shires Bill going again. We need to organize all the members of Audubon. He claimed there were 300,000 Audubon members in the country at that time, which I don't think was quite true. I hope they didn't trust him with Christmas bird count data, but maybe a little inflated. But he was still smart enough as a lobbyist to say to Congress, I got 300,000 people behind me, and they care, and they vote. And we want to protect migratory songbirds. But Pearson, that was a journey. And it took Hornaday to come along and say, look, migratory songbirds are not where it's at. And to be blunt, he said, who cares about migratory songbirds? It's women. Women don't have the right to vote in the United States yet. Right? It won't come until 1920. So we're not going to push through Congress this idea that we should somehow protect migratory songbirds. We've got to include game birds. We've got to get the sportsmen, even though we put them in the picture as the people destroying our nation's nature. We've got to get the sportsmen on board with a set of rules about hunting game birds. We've got to combine the ducks and the songbirds. Hornaday is a really fascinating guy. If you've been to the Smithsonian, he has one of the most famous, I'm not sure it's still there, it's been a while since I've been there, iconic dioramas of the bison. He was one of the first people who brought to the United States this idea that you don't just stuff animals and have them standing there rigidly on a peg, but you try to put them in a natural setting. He ran the New York Zoological Society and worked hard to, the zoo that he was running, we would consider to be incredibly barbaric, but it was a huge advance over what they had before in terms of habitat and trying to make things more natural for the animals. And so the Boy Scouts of America still apparently have a Louis T. Hornaday Award, which I only recently learned about. And obviously, as you can gather, he was not afraid to shoot anything. So Hornaday was controversial. One of his friends said he put a 13-inch hole through the hull of the enemy, but using a naval warfare analogy, which Hornaday loved. But other people found Hornaday to be unstoppable. So Hornaday and Pearson were looking for somebody in Congress to bring together this idea of protecting migratory songbirds, migratory game birds. And they found a sympathetic ear in Senator George McClain from Connecticut. His platform was Connecticut First. How that really is squared. I suppose his opponent's platform was Connecticut 47th, but he won the election. And so McClain from Connecticut, hence his warbler, introduced to Congress in 1913 with an ally from Massachusetts, Congressman John Weeks. This is Weeks. Weeks would go on to be Secretary of War, so here's his bird. the Weeks-McClain Act, a bill which was introduced to Congress in 1913, was about 4 pages long. Again, these really simple, straightforward bills from the early 20th century. And the point of the Weeks-McClain bill was straightforward. We are going to appoint experts. The progressive era, they loved experts. If you wore a white lab coat, you could do almost anything in the progressive era. So they were going to appoint experts from around the country. They would divide the birds of the country into different groups. So there would be game birds, ducks, woodcock, things like that, insectivorous birds, and then non-game birds. What's the most logical division? And so the experts would help divide up where each species would go. There would be this new crazy idea of closed seasons, that there would be times of the year when it would be illegal to hunt birds across the country. And the different regions would have different closed seasons based on where the migratory patterns were leading the birds. A crazy idea of bag limits. You couldn't just shoot all you wanted. You couldn't be a game hog anymore. The laws would force you to limit yourself, and again, that would be based on scientific knowledge. And what I think is most fascinating about this is that there were exemptions
So, for instance, most obviously there's an exemption for science. So if you were going to collect species for a scientific collection, you could very easily get a permit to go do that. But they also exempted a lot of Native American uses, because they understood, particularly in Alaska, that there were natives who lived on wild birds. They thought those birds weren't threatened, and so there were exemptions for them. There were exemptions for agriculture as well. So, for instance, blackbirds, if they were eating your crops, you could get an exemption from the Secretary of Agriculture to let you try to force those birds off by using violence against them. And Congress talks about weeks of claiming. They argue that it's not constitutional, the opponents. So in 1913, as William Howard Taft's term is ending in March, another guy named Byrd, goes and finds his friend, his old long-lost relative in Vermont, who's also named Burnham, and he says, one Burnham says to the other, will you take this Weeks-McLean bill and sneak it into the Agriculture Department Appropriations Act? And the other Burnham says, but then Taft's going to veto it. And the first Burnham says, yeah, but really, we have to protect the nation's birds. How else are we going to do this? If we don't get this done before Taft leaves, there's a whole new Congress that comes in. We start from scratch. Who knows when we get done? So Senator Burnham of Vermont agrees, slips the Weeks-McLean legislation into the Agriculture Department Appropriation Bill. Senator Taft, I'm not sure which one's Taft, but that mustache has got me a little confused. Taft signed the Agricultural Appropriations Act March 4th, 1913, the day he was packing the White House and leaving. And later, when somebody congratulated him on signing the Weeks-McLean bill, he said, I wouldn't have signed that. That was unconstitutional. And they said, oh, yeah, thanks. Yeah, you're right. It was unconstitutional. So Taft signed it without reading it. Does anybody know what Taft did after he was president? Supreme Court Justice.
Yes.
And in fact, he later became the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. He had pretty clear ideas of what was constitutional and what was not. This was pretty slippery on the conservationist part. So they got the Weeks-McLean Act through despite the constitutional objections. And not everybody was happy about this. So here's Elihu Root, who was Secretary of State under Theodore Roosevelt, conservative Republican Brahmin of the highest repute. He's watching the Senate do this. What's fascinating is he thinks this is completely unconstitutional, but he also thinks the birds have to be protected. So he keeps his mouth shut. And when he comes back in later 1913, the new Senate, he proposes a resolution to the Senate that the State Department should be empowered to negotiate a treaty with a neighboring country to protect the migratory birds, on the theory that the Constitution allows the federal government to negotiate treaties. And that's constitutional, but this meddling in migratory bird protection, that's clearly not constitutional. And the new president, Woodrow Wilson, I have some baseball theme going on here, I can't be spring soon enough. Woodrow Wilson is squarely behind this idea. He calls the State Department people together with the Agriculture Department people and says, come up with a plan to make this resolution reality. And a couple weeks later, they come back to him and they say, the first thing we need to negotiate is a treaty on releasing quail from Mexico. Which, as you know, is a burning issue in 1913 in America. Quail are running wild over the South. Now, I mean, I don't know why this is the first thing on their list. Second on their list is maybe the Migratory Bird Treaty with Mexico. Anybody know the history of Mexico in 1913? What's that? There's a gargantuan revolution going on in Mexico in 1913. And Woodrow Wilson helpfully said that when he was president, he would help teach the Mexicans to elect good men. So he was really popular in Mexico at that point, telling them he was going to teach them how to elect good men. So this idea of negotiating a treaty with Mexico was pretty clearly a stupid idea. It was not going to go anywhere. In fact, they don't negotiate a treaty with Mexico until 1936. So unfortunately, they did not wait until 1936. Instead, they turned, eventually, after a year of saying, well, we're Mexico negotiating with us. After about a year, they turned to Canada, which was about to enter World War I, you get distracted too. But this is E.W. Nelson, he's an American scientist, and he's done field work both in Mexico and in Canada, I think about biological survey, and he said, look, we gotta work with the Canadians, because the Canadians are in a position to help us in the way Mexico can't. And there's a scientific argument, look, but the Canada's got bird protection laws, and we really need to work with Mexico. Nelson's very much a pragmatist, I think that's an important part of the story. We can work with Canadians, we can get this done. This is about American law, not about
really protecting migratory birds throughout the atmosphere. And so he finds a Canadian scientist, a Dominion entomologist,
C. Gordon Hewitt. Looks a little bit like Robert Mueller now that I think about it. It's like, oh, I think I've seen that picture before. So now we know what Robert Mueller's previous life was. He was a Canadian entomologist. I could make a joke about stamping out insects, but I won't. Hewitt and Nelson, two scientists, get together and negotiate the terms of the treaty between the United States and Canada / Great Britain, because Canada's not having such a long cross. I think this is remarkable. The State Department has no clue what's going on. They don't want to know. The Canadian government is trying to figure out how to fight World War I, so they're like, let this Dominion entomologist work this out. We're fine with it. And in 1916, they actually agree to the terms of the treaty to protect the nation's wild birds. It basically takes the Weeks-McLean Act and turns it into a treaty. Almost identical terms. Of course, it still has to be signed by the king, it has to be signed by the president, the Senate has to ratify it, or excuse me, give advice and consent. So it still takes a little while to get through the wheels. And of course, at one point, the treaty actually gets lost in the British embassy. William Hornaday, for all of his problems, he's wondering what's happening to the treaty. He starts asking his friends, and the Canadians say, well, we sent it to you. And the Americans say, we sent it to you. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. We haven't heard from the British. So Hornaday literally went to the British embassy because he knew everybody. And he found the British ambassador. And he said, will you please find the migratory bird treaty because it's been lost? And they found it. It was in the wrong file. So who knows how long it would have sat there if Hornaday hadn't gotten it. So for all Hornaday's acerbic personality, sometimes a little sandpaper is a good thing. And so if this is the treaty, and this is the announcement of the treaties signing in August of 1916, this is Wilson sending it to the treaty, then the legislation came out, again, a very short bill, just a few pages, and it's sent to Congress in the spring of 1917, which is really not a good time to get Congress's attention since World War I has just broken out for the United States. But it will eventually come to Congress's attention. The center of the objection in the United States is the state of Missouri. And here's Senator James Reed from Missouri, who is the leader of the opposition in the Senate, and there's also a large opposition in the House. They generally come from the middle part of the country. Their principal objection is that this is not constitutional. If the Weeks-McLean law was unconstitutional as a piece of domestic legislation, you can't just sign a treaty that suddenly makes it constitutional. You can't just sign a treaty to give away Michigan because you don't like it. The treaty doesn't allow you to do things that you can't do domestically. That's his argument. It's also pretty clear that the people in the center of the country, particularly Missouri, have a particular love of hunting ducks in the spring for a variety of ecological reasons about when they can hunt ducks. And the Weeks-McLean Act, or the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, just took that away from them. The Weeks-McLean Act set up a system of wardens, including Ray Holland, who's one of the wardens. And they are kept on board when the Migratory Bird Treaty Act was passed in 1918. And Holland has the unhappy job of being in charge of Missouri, another large district. So when the Migratory Bird Treaty Act finally makes it through Congress, and it takes quite a while because, oh, I need to put up my eye candy for Reed. There it says Reed Warmer. It makes its way through Congress, not in 1917, even though the treaty is approved in the summer of 1916. It has to wait until 1918. Because the Wilson administration has said nothing will go through Congress in 1917 is not war related. So conservationists have to organize themselves to make a case that this is actually war related legislation. Which they do. They start arguing that birds eat insects. Insects eat crops. Crops feed the troops. Crops feed the starving people in Belgium. So they literally wrap the flag around migratory birds, and basically anything with wings is now an insectivore, saving our crops from the German enemy, basically. So the hunters, in fact, at one point, one of the critics of Missouri people said, there are a lot of people who speak German in that part of the country, aren't there? Making the point that it's basically that they're almost treasonous in their opposition, that they don't want to volunteer, they don't want to fight. Interestingly, the opposition to the treaty turns it around and says, and this is one great quote from a Southern senator, you will sissify our boys if you don't let them go out and hunt birds. He said that God made woodpeckers and meadowlarks for hunting, and that was their purpose, and so you're taking us away from them. And why are we talking about this when U-boats are barking and biting at our doors? So it became an argument about the war and about the federal role in advancing policies during the war. But Wilson decides, yes, it's a war measure. He's got enough votes in Congress. He pushes it through. But as you know, just because a law is passed doesn't mean it's constitutional. So Holland catches, not Reed, but the Attorney General of the state of Missouri violating the Migratory Bird Treaty Act. He catches him in the spring with a collection of ducks. Hornaday claims that the Attorney General gave a fake name, but I don't know if I really believe that. I think it's pretty well known who the Attorney General of Missouri is if you're Ray Holland working in Missouri. So Holland, you know, basically files charges against him for violating the Migratory Bird Treaty Act in 1919. The Attorney General turns around and sues Holland and says this law, the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, is not actually constitutional. So you actually don't have a right to stand up for that. That's a quite a right. I once had a student who had a 50-cent rap song play on his keyboard, and it went off twice, and I said, okay, you owe me $1 for the twice. He started thought about it for a second. So Missouri versus Holland, the court case, comes out of the Migratory Bird Treaty Act. And this is the pivotal moment in the whole story. Because the Supreme Court might come out and say, you know, you can't actually make something constitutional by signing a treaty if it was unconstitutional before. The Migratory Bird Treaty Act had actually been challenged in court. And the local courts had ruled against the Weeks-McLean Act. The Weeks-McLean Act from 1913 had been challenged, and the local courts had ruled against it. It had gotten to the Supreme Court, that challenge, in 1916. Then the Migratory Bird Treaty was signed, and both sides agreed to wait and see what happened with the act that came out of the treaty. So Holmes, sitting on the Supreme Court in 1920, has to write the decision in Missouri versus Holland. And in a 7-2 vote, Holmes, writing for the majority, rules that in fact the United States does have the right to protect migratory birds. What's really fascinating about it is he does not make a constitutional argument, he makes a pragmatic argument. He says, look, the states claim ownership. This is the core of the constitutional argument, that the states own wildlife and therefore it's not a federal job. He says, and I think this was a little bit of a pun on his part, that's leaning on a slender reed, Senator Reed. And he says, in fact, nobody owns them because they are here today and gone tomorrow. That's the nature of migratory birds. So therefore, only the federal government, or better yet, an international treaty, could possibly protect them. And they are of the national interest. And the war is over by now, but protecting migratory birds is of the national interest. And therefore, you can't read this as a constitutional issue, but who has the authority and the ability to protect what is in the national interest? Only the federal government. And so Missouri versus Holland is a really important court case for establishing protection of nature by the federal government. Interestingly, I gave a talk about this to the UNH Law School several years ago, and they had all heard of Missouri versus Holland, but they had no idea what the context was, because it was being taught in law school about the expansion of federal power, which is what it is, but they weren't focusing at all on why migratory birds came to that law. I thought it was the worst bowl game in history, Missouri versus Holland, but it turned out actually important for this. So when we look at the Migratory Bird Treaty Act and really everything that came after it, so much of it depends on these decisions in 1910, 12, 13, and then up to 18. Our migratory birds got this new lease on life, and statistics show a rebound of the populations into the 1920s and 1930s. And more importantly, I think the case that came out of Missouri versus Holland shaped our understanding of the Constitution and our understanding of what the federal government can do in reaching out to other nations to help protect migratory birds. So thank you very much for your attention. I'd be happy to take questions. Let's just put a pretty bird up on it. Yes?
I'm just wondering, wondering, at the beginning, you mentioned threats to the, you know, political climate.
Yes.
What specifically do you see of them challenging in the treaty?
So the bill basically says you can't kill migratory birds. And over the course of the years, the courts have particularly focused on the idea of what needs to take. So there was a pretty important expansion of the understanding of taking in the 1980s when one of the wildlife refuges in the Central Valley of California, basically they were pumping recycled irrigation water back into the wildlife refuge and had a really high selenium level. And so the grebes that were nesting there, for instance, were coming out across bills, all sorts of really terrible defects. And they figured out it was the selenium levels. And so the courts pretty bluntly expanded taking to things like that, that were not, I mean, the point wasn't to kill migratory birds, but it was to kill migratory birds. And so the court expanded the idea of taking. So, you know, legally, if you drive down the road and hit a migratory bird and kill it, you've just taken it, and you don't have a permit to do that. Now, as a lawyer, a friend pointed out to me, you know, nobody would want to waste the resources going after one person actually to bird the car, but that is kind of illegal. So what the Trump administration is doing, and what there's actually a proposal in Congress that I saw was still alive in late February, to basically clarify that if your business in the course of normal operations ends up taking migratory birds, you are exempt. So this is particularly a problem, for instance, if you have a pool of oil that is mistaken for water and migratory birds land on it. Under the old rules, you could be held accountable because you should know better that that would be a potentially attractive nuisance. And under the new rules that they've already, in effect, started, and they said they're not going to enforce it, but there's still Congress is going to come along and make this a law rather than just the Trump administration's decision, is that if that's just part of your normal business, then we're not going to come after you. We're only going to go after people who are specifically doing things that they should know are a threat to migratory birds that are different from normal work. So the interpretation I'm reading, and I don't know if this is going to be true, because we'll see, I mean, it all depends on how the courts interpret it, right? That one of the things I read recently was that, for instance, the BP oil spill in the Gulf, one of the reasons they had to do a lot of remediation was they had taken birds. But it's possible under the new interpretation that, well, they weren't trying to take birds, they had their well below. And so that's no longer would be considered taking under, therefore, violation of the act. And that could be a pretty big threat, of course, because, you know, what you try to do. So I think that's the big threat right now. You know, on one hand, I can understand why the definition of taking might need to be refined, but this is opening up a can of worms. And it's good
to be. Environmental influence
impacts. Exactly. Environmental impacts would be huge.
Is anybody trying to fight that?
Well, sure. I mean, I've been reading about it because of, I mean, you actually did. You sent me one of those articles right when we agreed to give the talk, and I know, certainly Audubon has been fighting it. They've been pushing back on it. Particularly, Congressman Cheney from Wyoming is the one who put forth the resolution to amend the Migratory Bird Treaty Act specifically, so it's not just an administrative decision, it's just more of a permanent move. So you can certainly write to, I mean, if anybody comes from a place where there's a Republican congressman or senator, you want to write to them, right? Because I'm sure the Democrats are pretty much uniformly opposing it, but maybe write to Susan Collins and tell her the incredibly stupid idea this is to weaken the Migratory Bird Treaty Act. I mean, it, you know, it's not like there's so many birds around that we can afford to lose a few. So that would be the main thing to do.
Well, the government has regulatory divisions in place for not only migratory birds, but also for green mammals.
Yes.
That things are going to die that they can't see.
Right.
As they're constructing things like that. Whenever they build a pier, whenever they build a head base.
Yes.
Things do not happen, but it's not intentional. And they
right.
have to document, they have to track it.
Yeah.
They have to report and everything else, but they can't say it because this has to be built in that winter.
Right.
That goes along with the consent.
Exactly. So one of the things that, you know, that comes out of the idea of the Missouri versus Holland, I think, in terms of the intellectual basis, is the idea of the environmental impact statement, right? That almost anything the federal government does now has an environmental impact statement, which started in the 1970s, that you have to explain what the environmental costs are. Everybody wants to hear about this lecture. Tell me it's great. So the environmental impact statement is related. If you're going to build a pier that might interfere with whales, you have to explain why it's worth it anyway.
So, yeah, I wrote my second book about whaling in the 20th century, so if you're interested in whales, I really like I give a pretty good talk about that, too. I love to talk about whales. And if you bring Bradley's, I'll come talk every book. Can I go more?
Talking about the iteration of the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, are there still exemptions for native peoples taking, and are they based on like studies of the population of both the people and the birds to ensure they're sustainable?
You know, that's a great question. I know, for instance, there are some restrictions, some limits, or there are not limits, for instance, on eagle feathers. Like there are restrictions that natives are allowed to have eagle feathers that non-natives cannot have. I don't know about the continued taking of the northern parts of Alaska, which is what they were really thinking about. And I suspect that Interior has not really been doing a lot to study this. I'm pretty sure that exemption has not been rolled back because it would be political dynamite to roll those back. I mean, to come back to the whale question, right? And this is in the 90s, so that long ago, the McCall, I'm going to go back to Huckering Whales because we got a treaty right. And the federal government said, you sure do, so we're going to let you do it. So I don't think that has been rolled back. I also think that the reality is that they might find themselves, as they did with the whales, asking really politely for the indigenous users to tone it down if they were taking too many because of the ramifications that they allowed them to take.
What it has to do with the numbers?
It has to do with numbers, with the species they're taking and how many they're taking. That's what caused the whales, right? In whales in the 1970s, it was when the take spiked in the middle of the 1970s. And it went from being something they literally did not care about to something that became an international issue. One of the things I found in my research was that the government of New Zealand in 1977 had a 50-page memorandum on go ahead and whale hunting on the coast of Alaska. This is how international it became in the short space of time. Was there another question here? Yeah.
Is there a similar discussion going on in Canada like this, or is there anything with it that set up similar?
Right, so early, the Canadian government didn't have constitutional issues because their constitution set in 1867 by the British government allowed them to put this system in place more easily than the U.S. did. So it wasn't a constitutional crisis, but there was a setting up of a national board to, there was a setting up of a national board to make sure that Canada had the same set of rules that were reasonably based on science to the best of their abilities, similar exemptions. And to my knowledge, the migratory bird legislation in Canada has not been challenged in a serious way. Although interestingly, Canada does not have an endangered species act, for instance. So it has a various different set of rules, but a larger commitment at this point.
There is something like that. UNH is working on a project for Arctic research and oil drilling and the impact of migratory birds going through the area.
Yeah.
The impact is through UNH's protocol.
Interesting. Yeah, that they're working with Canadian authorities on that?
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Well, that's good. Good.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.